Hello, everybody. Welcome to the show. Very excited. Again, we're into our second season, is the way we look at it. This is a co-presentation of the Classic TV Preservation Society, which is a nonprofit organization that is dedicated to the positive influence of classic television shows. A core function of the Classic TV Preservation Society are the TV and self-esteem seminars that we bring to schools and colleges and community centers and senior centers and business facilities all over the country. And it's really neat because we get to talk with individuals who grew up with the shows, the original, during the original viewings, and then new viewers who are finding these programs on networks like Cozy TV and what else we got? Antenna TV and Me TV and Hallmark Channel even certainly has been a huge supporter of classic television. Anyway, we have a very special guest tonight, and before
we get to that guest.
I'd like to. I was at the Collector Show, the Cinecon Film Festival, Classic Film Festival last week at the Egyptian, and they have, you know, like the dealer rooms or whatever. And I came across a commencement speech by David Wolper, huge television producer, star producer. One of his most important productions, and I believe this is correct, was Roots, which became one of the most historic miniseries of all times. So I came across it, I had to purchase it, and what he wrote at that speech just spoke to me personally. It spoke to what the Classic TV Preservation Society is all about. And I just wanted to read a little bit. He wrote it 4 years ago. So I just want to read a little bit of it because it's just phenomenal. So if you could just bear with me a little bit while I set it up, while I sit down and get this paperwork in my hand. And I'm just going to jump around because it, you know, goes on forever. And by the way, what I really love about tonight is there's one guest. It's going to be one focus, so we can talk about everything. All right. This is David Wolper. I think that's how you say his name. He wrote probably 1975, 1976, somewhere around there, 77. I believe strongly that television audiences want to be educated and informed, that they just crave information. Why not transmit the information in the form and arena that mass audiences want to receive it in by way of Charlie's Angels, All in the Family, Little House on the Prairie, Quincy, MASH, these are all classic TV shows. Let's use those shows to help in the educational process. Let's use those shows as our form to transmit ideas of a socially significant nature. Why not explore the problems of old age on an episode of The Rockford Files, or investigate drug abuse on Starsky and Hutch? Problems of alcoholism could be examined in an episode of Charlie's Angels, and a woman's life after divorce can easily be included in an episode of Laverne and Shirley. The recent miniseries, the recent at that time, transmitted Holocaust, transmitted to over 100 million people a better understanding of that tragic event. Eleanor and Franklin gave us an insight into the meaning and contributions of the lives of those two historic people. Eleanor and Franklin was a miniseries. And Roots, the most watched television program of all time, and I think it still is, reached over 250 million people throughout the world, telling the background and history of slavery through the eyes of Alex Haley's ancestors. Alex Haley was the author of the novel that series is based on. More people were educated about slavery during those 8 days and 12 hours than in all the books and lectures in the past 200-year history of this country. There are so many things that can be done on the popular television show, on popular television shows. So many people can be touched, and it can be done with taste and understanding in an entertaining fashion. Let's not fall into the notion that quality diminishes in direct proportion to popularity, because it's just not true. We can be successful in disseminating more information and improve the quality and the value of television by convincing networks to include on a regular basis information and socially significant themes in the current popular television shows of the day. Television is the most influential means of propagating ideas in this country today. It is instantaneous in its reach and intimate in its reception. It can exercise the most extraordinary sensory and emotional appeal. It molds minds, fixes modes of perception, and determines what is thought of as desirable and even real for millions of people. The students are out there, 100 million of them, yearning for information. I humbly suggest this is one way to reach them. Thank you. I mean, isn't that amazing? He wrote that, all those years ago. And yes, sir.
Just to qualify what you said, I want to rain on your parade here, Herbie.
Okay, fine. We'll cut it.
To qualify what David L. Wolper was saying.
Yes.
Is his own background. Not only did he do Roots, but he went on to do the Thornbirds. But the educational aspect of his background, he brought the world, the undersea world of Jacques Cousteau.
Oh my gosh, yes.
So,
even though it preempted Bewitched every time.
he had the qualifications to say that.
Yes. Oh, of course. Of course. Thank you, Brett. So let's have a hand for all of that. But seriously, when I picked it up, in the dealer room that day, I'm like, did I write this? Did somebody take this from me? It's kind of amazing. All right, we're gonna move on to introducing my wonderful, wonderful guest. Sound like Lawrence Welk. Wonderful, wonderful. That's done. I think all of us had a crush on her on Saturday mornings growing up in the 70s. She brought to her role as Holly on Land of the Lost something that was very accessible, that was so real, that was so telling, so honest, and just so likable. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce you to Kathy Coleman.
Kathy,
so nice to meet you.
Hug. Oh, of course. You have a seat here. It smells so pretty. All right.
Oh, thank you.
Take that microphone.
You know who doesn't like this perfume?
Who?
Chaka.
Oh. And someone just said, I told
Chaka.
You. Someone just said, did she play Chaka on Land of the Lost?
Not me, you. Oh, I thought you said, did I play
it? No. Someone just asked me if I played.
Right.
So you wrote a book, and we're going to get into that.
Okay.
But in general, what was the experience like playing Holly on Land of the Lost? In general, we'll start there.
Okay, let's see. I never had a series before, so I didn't really know what to expect. I'd done some commercials, and I had been in a band for a couple of years, and so I was okay to entertain. I that was just like a natural for me. If somebody would look at me and give me an audience for just even a second, it was dun 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 dun, dun. I was all into it. So I was okay with that. I wasn't nervous or anything. I just didn't know what the daily grind was going to be, what was going to be expected of me. And I didn't have an understanding that this was going to become like another family for me, and it really was. And it wasn't just the father, the brother, and Chaka. It was also the Slee Stacks and the other Pakuni and the prop master and the camera guys and the makeup man. It was like where I hung out all the time between him and the prop guy, and just everybody on the set became like this big, gigantic family for me. And I came from a big family. I'm the youngest of 10 kids and a single mom. And it was just, it was a terrific experience.
What do you recall of your audition? Or how did that all happen?
It was just like every week, I'd be in school and I'd come home and my mom would say, you have an interview today. And so, it could be for anything, a pilot for a new series or what have you, or a commercial or anything. And so I would go on these interviews. Well, that day it was for Land of the Lost. And it's funny because the week before, I went on an interview for a show called Run, Joe, Run. I don't know if anybody ever saw that show. But it was down to Christy McNichol and I after they had seen everybody for the callbacks and stuff.
Is it Burt Reynolds? Is it Burt Reynolds?
No, yeah. No, it was about a German Shepherd.
Oh, okay. It's not Burt Reynolds.
Anyway, so she wound up getting it, and it filmed that next week, and it was just one episode. And had I got that episode, I wouldn't have been able to audition for Land of the Lost, and you know, the rest is history on that. But I did go on 7 interviews, callbacks. I had to meet with the rest of the cast that they had picked to see if we all like, you know, got along and we had chemistry, and I had to meet with the presidents of like NBC and the director and everybody, you know, they all kind of wanted.
Well, what was it, do you think, in you that they saw that they liked? And did they tell you that yet? Did they tell you why you got the part, or?
Well, because I'm just so awesome. No, no, actually. No, actually, it's kind of funny because you wouldn't know it today because my voice is so deep. But back then, I had this really high-pitched voice. And David Gerald, who was the creator, he wrote for Star Trek, Trouble with Tribbles. Anyway, so he was the creator of Land of the Lost. And he told Marty Croft, he said, "Oh, that kid's voice," he said, "I just can't take another second of it." He goes, "I don't know if I'm going to be able to sit in the control room and listen to that pitch of, Will, you know, I just can't do it." And Marty said, "Yeah," but he goes, "Other than that," he goes, I love the kid." He goes, "It's just that voice." And Marty told him, he says, "I'll take care of the voice. I'll handle that." And so apparently the first day on the set, I hit one of those high notes and they all came running out of the control booth, you know. Anyway, I guess I learned to control my high pitchedness to some degree, but.
Well, it was one of your,
anyway,
likable aspects, I think. I think that's what.
It was just who I was. Yeah. I didn't have like a, I was a singer, so I did have some voice control, but I mean, I was just a kid.
Right.
I was a kid, and I'm sure there were times when I was on the stage that they probably cut my mic if I hit a sour note. But, you know, I was a kid.
So, now, you know, a lot of child stars, and former child stars, they have had their challenges. And I'm sensing that's the reason what brought you to write your book, which, by the way, is called Lost Girl, The Truth, Nothing But The Truth, So Help Me Kathleen.
Mm-hmm.
So explain how you came to write the book, why you decided to write the book, and then we'll get into the book.
Okay, there was a pattern that I noticed. It started when I was on the Dinah Shore show, when I was about 12, I guess. It was pretty fresh into having the show. And I got on the show and she said, "Oh, I bet you the kids at school just love you. I bet you're really popular." And I said, "No," because I wasn't popular. I mean, everybody knew who I was, but they didn't like me because I didn't make sense to them. I was different, and I lived in a town that didn't have other kids that were in the industry. I lived in Simi Valley at the time. And the reason I lived there was because of my mother, who made a promise to me if I ever got a television series that she would get me a pony. And she stayed true to her word and she got me my pony. And because I had now a horse, I needed to live in a place that was zoned for horses, and that was Simi Valley. So I was in and out of school. I would go to school, public school, during hiatus, and the kids didn't know what to make of me. And people would say to me, "Oh, they're just jealous, you know, they're just jealous." And I always felt bad for the kids that the adults would put that label on them, and it made me feel awkward because I knew it wasn't that they were jealous. It was the curiosity and the confusion that was really what was causing them to be so damn mean to me, you know? They didn't know any better. I was an oddity to them. I was this person who was on television, and I came and I went, and I didn't fit in. I was used to being around adults my entire life, pretty much adults. I was the youngest in my family, so everybody, there was like, some of my siblings are a good 15 years older than I am, so I lived in a very adult world at home, and I lived in an adult world when I went to work. So,
and it's interesting you say that, because I think there was, you were a very adult Holly. I think that was the other thing too. It wasn't like you were a kid. You were an old soul, and I think we saw that in the series. So it's interesting that you just said that.
Well, because I think we were poor in the sense that we were super rich in the fact that my mother provided us with more than I think most wealthy families had, as far as trips that we went on, camping trips and simple things that were fun. I know I wrote in the book about some of these tragic things that happened to me in my life, and they're just to kind of share with people that, you know what, I was stupid. I did dumb things and I tolerated things in my life. But, you know, it's more so to show you that we're really kind of all in this together, you know, we all try to.
So the issues or the challenges that you had weren't necessarily bred because of Hollywood. It's just that because you were in Hollywood, everything you did was only exacerbated, or because you were in the public eye, it wasn't really any different than others.
I don't think so. People used to say to me, oh, you know, did you ever have like a drug problem or anything? And I said, you know, because you were a child star. And I said, no different than the newspaper boy, you know. As a matter of fact, I think we got our stuff from the newspaper boy, you know. I mean, and I have, in my life, I have lived in the wealthiest of families and lived in the poorest of families and everything in between, every color, every creed, every nation. I have been a part of their lives to some degree. And it's across the board. I mean, my first husband that I had my children with, his family are the founders of Bel Air, California. That's like this old money and old way of thinking. And they had seven boys, and there wasn't one Puritan in the bunch. They were all, you know, they all should have books like mine, you know? So.
Well, let's get into the book. And I really do love the style that you wrote it in, and I'll just give one
truth.
Well, truth, but you write well is what I'm saying.
It's you.
This in this little paragraph really signifies it. I think you're talking about your mom.
Mm-hmm.
This is her speaking now, writing. My mother was very young and naive. I have compassion for her for a lot of that. She seemed to be just constantly out of place. She'd come on the set of Land of the Lost, and it was always, you know, excuse me, lighting coming through, cable coming through, etc. She has always managed to be standing in the wrong spot. I think she must have felt that way in life, always in the wrong spot. I mean, that's just so nicely presented. And really, it's the core of the book. Your relationship with your mom was a setting theme, yes?
Mm-hmm.
So
she was a huge part of my life. I spent a more intimate time with her than I think any of my other siblings. She came on tour with me when I was in the band for the 2 years I traveled, and she was on the set with me every day. My other sisters went through puberty and things like that, and they just kind of did it behind like closed bedroom doors, like, you know, when they started to become women and stuff. And my mother was like very hands-on. I mean, every single change that took place in my life, she was, you know, watching it. So she was very much a part of my everything, my diet. You know, the other kids, I come from a pretty much heavy family. Everyone's, you know, a good 50 or more overweight, and I wasn't ever going to be that way because I had a different father, and I did not know that until I was 18 years old.
Okay, so break that down. Break down the siblings. How many you have, and the differences?
Well, there's six of us still living, three boys, three girls.
And how many were there originally?
10.
Wow.
My mom lost her first baby. Anyway, this whole thing, this diet thing that she had me on when I was growing up, was unnecessary. And so there was this like lie going on, and it was very odd.
Lie?
It was a lie that I felt when I finally found out the truth. It saddened me because she had been hiding this truth about me being different and treating me so oddly that I felt bad for her because she was all I ever knew. And I loved her, you know. I didn't know who the father was. I didn't know who the one that they said might be, you know. I didn't know anybody. I just knew her. And
do you think that was the seeds of why you started to drink?
Actually, I think I had lived under such control growing up that by the time I turned 18 and got that trust fund and my brand new Mustang, it was just like, I just went like wild. I didn't have to weigh in every day. I didn't have to.
And what year was this? Just to clarify.
When I was 18.
Well, it was 70.
Oh, 1980, I turned 18. And I probably got my money too. But you know what, you can say I probably shouldn't have got my money when I did, maybe wait until I was in my 30s or something. You know, it's life. It all came when it was supposed to come, and I learned all my lessons, and some of them were, I was a little thick in the skull, I guess. I had to get really bashed over my head to really get it through me, you know?
So Land of the Lost was canceled after 3 years, and what year did it end?
76.
Okay, so what was going on with your career after the show ended?
Actually, I was getting ready to turn 15, and there's not a lot of work in the industry from 15 to 18. They can get somebody that's 18 that looks 15, you know, that's easy. So
did you have trouble getting work after Land of the Lost? I'm just trying to see if there was some path to, you know, again, you reaching out and trying to find comfort in other things.
I just wasn't getting sent out a lot, you know, because my agent already, they weren't calling on me because of my age. These people that would have called me would have known how old I was, so I wouldn't go out on as many interviews as I used to go out on. I kind of became a little unworkable. And so, but I did, which was the craziest thing, when I was almost 18 years old, like 17 and 11 months or something, I got a series of Burger King commercials. And it was weird because we went in groups of four on the audition, and they pulled three girls from one group and they pulled me from a different group. And these girls were all like 21, and I was, you know, 17 and 11 months, and I got the job singing with them, as a matter of fact. So.
You met a lot of stars. I mean, either through...
Oh, a ton.
Your pop, ton. Talk about some of the, like, oh,
well,
was it Elton John?
Well, my mother actually met him. She met him in the parking lot of Land of the Lost. Anyway, she was funny because she came in, she says, oh, I met the nicest guy, crazy looking, you know. And my mom had this really beautiful Australian accent. It was very musical when she'd speak. She said, nutty as a loon, the way he looked, you know. And but yeah, I mean, I remember when I was about 10, I could have been 11, but I was at the Schubert Theater, and I had Burt Bacharach on one hand and George Burns on the other, And Helen Reddy, I think, might have been on Burbank Rack's other hand. And I was with, and my band members were there as well. And we were belting out I Am Woman, and it just made me laugh because hold the kids' ears. But I didn't have...
You can tell me.
Anyway, I didn't have one pubic hair.
Oh, okay.
And I'm screaming, I Am Woman, here, you know. And it was just very funny at the time. We were all laughing so hard.
Tell us about my favorite celebrity that when you met Elizabeth Montgomery, or at least you saw her. What happened that day?
Oh my goodness, was now that up, ever sir. So much fun. I just think that she was just the everything woman. I just think she was just everything, and the true sensualness to me of a human being, or the attractiveness of them, is somebody that behind their eyes has a secret, and it shines through. That secret of, they know something about life that's so exciting, that just glows. They just glow because they've got that. Paul McCartney has it. That's secret. Like that's why he's so charming, because he's just got a secret. So anyway, I'm in Century City once again, and it's an NBC press party, and there's all kinds of celebrities. I had stepped outside of it, got thrown out, couldn't get back in. Hogan's Heroes, Bob Crane dragged me back in, helped me out. He goes, come on, kid, you can come in with me, you know. And I said, no, I'm really supposed to be in here. And he said, I know. He says, I've got your show on VHS, which is, that's how long ago this was. So I go in there after Bob Crane pulls me back in. And I see this circle of men, very, very attractive men, all in nice clothes and everything. And I look in what's in the middle of their circle, and there's Elizabeth Montgomery. And I just stood there just watching her, and just watching how she charmed and entertained all of these men simultaneously. There wasn't one in the group that didn't think that he was the one of the group that made her day. She just was able to just give it to everybody equally. And I thought, you are one heck of a woman. I would love to be like you someday. And instead, I learned to be like me. And I'm
But you still captured all of us. Well, like I said, that we all had crushes on you. I mean, you were just, you were adorable. Still are.
I just want to end that one story that I was talking about, I forget where we were, but anyway.
Before Elizabeth Montgomery, before that?
Yeah, it was way before Elizabeth Montgomery.
Back up the tape.
No, it's okay. It was just what I wanted to say, though, was that I know what it was. I said that some of the lessons that I had to learn, you know, because I had a thick skull, I had to have my head bashed in a few times to finally get it through my thick skull. One of them that was really hard for me was that somehow, somewhere, when I was a little kid, somebody told me that I wasn't valuable or something to that effect, that I bought hook, line, and sinker. Like, oh, she's fine. People used to say that to me all the time, she'll be fine. And they just sort of just thought I could just handle everything. And that kind of made me not stand up for myself in life. And so when I finally learned that I was very valuable, it changed everything. It changed everything. And I think that's like in that book, if I can get that across, that I'm smiling. It's like I want everybody who's ever had those feelings that they're not good enough to just know, man, we got the seal of approval. You know those stickers in your shirts that say, you know, inspected by? We got the inspection from, you know, the big guy. And I wear that proudly today.
That's so beautiful. Do you realize that, I mean, just right now...
And I'm not crying because I'm sad. I'm happy.
And we're happy to have you here. Completely happy. Please applaud. But do you realize that, you know, the lives here that you're touching, just in this room, and then certainly when we show this on YouTube or whatever, not to mention the millions of lives, all the joy that you've brought to so many lives. And I believe that when we leave this world, we get to take all of that joy with us to wherever we believe heaven is, or however we're going to define it, and we get to relive it again and again. So not only, you know, will you bring the joy that you experience, in my view of things, will you bring the joy that you experienced in your show and in your life, but all the other stuff will be gone, and then you'll get to take with you the millions and millions and millions of joyful moments that you created with others.
I think it's very funny that you say that, because I also believe that heaven is also on earth. And at these conventions, I meet with the fans and they share their stories with me. And so that reliving, I'm actually being able to do that right here and now. And people that tell me, like people that before this evening got started and I came up here, I was talking to some of the people in the audience, and we got to just share some really cool stuff. So yeah, oh God, it's wonderful. Are you kidding me? That's why I continue to keep doing these shows. It's not for the money. I mean, the money's, you know, it just pays for me to get there again, you know, to the next one, basically. Oh, I've got a collection of them. Thank you. Well, people know me, I guess. What's that? Oh, that's Tracy.
Thank you, Tracy. Will you come back next week and do that for everybody? Tell me something. Do you believe that the struggles that you had even as a child, and then later on as a young adult and then an adult, did that contribute to your art as an actress? Are you a better actress? Were you a better performer on Land of the Lost because of the struggles that you went through? Did you use any of that?
Well, for crying scenes, maybe, or emotional scenes, maybe. But as far as like the kind of tomboy type personality that I think Holly had, and the didn't take any guff kind of personality, I mean, that was just who I was as a kid. And my sense of adventure, I mean, for me, I write a lot about some of the sad things that happened to me in my life, and people say, oh God, I feel so bad for you. You know what? That's just some of the stuff. That's like not even, that doesn't even really touch on everything that I did in my life. I had so much fun, and fun with like really simple things too, like my sister and I. We'd get a coffee can, and when we were camping, run down to the river and collect pollywogs all day. That to me, and I feel sad for some of the kids today that don't get to have those simple, basic, tons of fun moments.
In and out of the entertainment industry in general.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, those little, we got a little paper bag of our penny candies. We could sit down at that river all day long. It was a blast.
Right. Because going for an ice cream has been a simple treasure, like going for an ice cream or just walking along the beach has been lost in iPads and smartphones.
Right, and we were saying, you know, Saturday mornings used to be something that you went to school all week long, your parents worked all week. Come Saturday morning, they were in bed, they were zoned out because they worked so hard all week long. And so that became your very private moment and, you know, you got your bowl of Cocoa Puffs and you had at it, you know, in front of the TV. It was your moment. Today, there's just so much, yeah. Whatever floats your boat. I always now say whatever floats your raft.
Was in a raft.
But, yeah, I mean, the kids have so many options today. There's
too
just,
many.
Yeah, it's...
So what's the answer?
Which
how
one?
How can we simplify things? I mean, now they're trying to shut, you know, they have like shut off days or, you know, non-smartphone days and all of that. Dewire yourself, whatever the phrase is.
Unplug.
Thank you. Dewire.
I think it's like our diets is portion control, you know, the way that we eat. You know, you can't, you can have pizza, you can have ice cream, you can have all of that stuff, but, you know, you can't have it Monday through Friday every night, you know, but how about once a week? Can we do that? The same thing I think should be with entertainment for your children and how you spend time with them is portion control. If they want to play with the computer, you sit down with them and you both learn stuff because your kids, because they've morphed into computer wizards right out of the chute these days, they can teach you things. And so just anything that you choose to do, to just do it together and then put the computer down. Today it's fishing or camping or hiking or, you know, let's do some artwork, you know, even if you don't know how to do it, both of you sit there and just struggle together to figure something out, you know.
That deserves applause. Thank you very much.
Do anything. Spend some time with your kids, you know, like my mother did. There's no excuse, well, we don't have the money. My mother had nothing. She had nothing, and all those kids, yet she provided us with so much on so little.
Amazing.
You know, all the odds against her, too. She struggled with, you know, being here in this country. She came here when she was young, and her dream kind of shattered with her romance. You know, she married a soldier and came here, and she thought she was going to be the, you know, the cat's meow in his eyes, and she wasn't. She, you know, her heart was broken, and so she put all of her energy and her love into something, you know, positive, which she was smart to switch gears, you know, when you need to in life.
Adapt. She adapted.
Yeah.
Which you have as well. Wouldn't you say you have adapted through your life?
Absolutely. I'm a chameleon.
Okay. Why don't we open the floor up?
Okay.
And take some questions. Bump up the lights, as Carol Burnett used to say. I like saying that every day. So if you have any questions for our wonderful guest, please raise your hand and don't be shy. Yes, sir.
When did the book come out?
In April.
So have you been doing book tours?
No, but I have been bringing them to the shows, to the conventions.
Good.
So, yeah.
Sounds like a good read.
Oh, you'll have to read it.
It's a great read. It's awesome. Honest.
Would you like to do more book tours?
Absolutely. I would like to get it into the hands of many people as I possibly could. Absolutely. So that when, you know, if I ever run into you, we can have like a good laugh. Like, oh, I remember that one thing you said. You know what? I did the exact same thing and I thought it was just me. No, you know what? We're all very similar. So.
Yes, Frank.
I'm just thinking what a great first series experience that was as a young actor. You worked with all sorts of different characters and creatures. What was it like doing like special effects shots where they put a dinosaur in? Was that particularly challenging to act as a young actor without someone to play against?
As far as a first show to be on, there wasn't, for a kid, there wasn't a better set to be on than my set. We had two sound stages, and it was caves and ponds and all kinds of stuff going on. When it came to the special effects, when we had dinosaurs involved and things like that, I was on a wall that was about twice the height of this ceiling and about as wide as, I don't know, half this room. And it was called chroma key, and now they call it a green screen, but it was about the color of your t-shirt right there. We, you know, spent half the day on chroma key, so.
Nothing green about that blue.
No, I know, but it's now green, but it used to be chroma key blue.
Yes, Brett.
You mentioned the two sound stages. Where was Land of the Lost produced?
The first two seasons, it was at, it was called General Services on Santa Monica and Las Palmas.
Now Hollywood Center Studio.
Yes, yes. And Glenn Sound was right behind us, and we used to do our looping there.
Yeah.
And the third season was over at Samuel Goldwyn.
Okay. It was all done on video.
Yes, compact video.
Wow.
Yeah.
So did you all get together with like the Lidsville people and the H.R. Puffin stuff people and have a big party, or was it a little bit of after those shows, or what? Did you interact with them?
I saw them at press parties, some of them. We did a one time, because the Croft offices, their main like storage facilities and everything are in Sunland. And I remember they had one big party, and it was at the time when they were producing the Brady Bunch variety show and Donnie and Marie and all of that. So it was kind of a cool party because it was like, there's Greg Brady. it was just weird, you know. And I try to tell that to people when I do these shows, by the way, about this whole oneness thing that I'm really all about, is that I know what it's like to be on this side of the table, and I know what it's like to be on that other side of the table. And I just think, I mean, I don't know if you guys are fans of mine or what to, how do you even say that without sounding like a, you know.
We're fans.
Okay. But I just think if, like, for me, like, if I could have, like, come to something like this or gone to a convention and met David Cassidy, I was like, I'd have been, like, out of my mind. I'd have been so, so happy. Back then, you know, the celebrities were, you know, on the television, and
right.
Unless you were part of the...
They weren't accessible.
Not at all. I mean, I got to meet some of them because I was in the business, like Leif Garrett was one of my crushes, and I actually got to date him. Uh-oh. When we were kids.
How's he doing?
I haven't talked to him in many years. But my friend Chaka sees him at parties once in a while.
How was it like going to school in your junior high school years when you were filming?
Oh, you came in late. We already talked about that, yeah. But you already know because you went to school with me, so therefore I don't need to.
Different point of view.
These two girls in the back here, they went to junior high school with me.
So they loved you. You did have friends then.
I did have friends. I had a few friends.
You get her the hell out of school and go horseback riding. Oh.
Yeah.
Do you have a question?
Oh, yeah. I wanted to ask you about the movie they made.
The Will Ferrell movie.
Will Ferrell movie. And fans have different opinions about it.
Mm-hmm. But
and you talk about this in the book. So, you know, why I think it didn't succeed, too, because I related to that book. We'll talk about it. Yeah.
Okay, is your question, did I like it? Which side of the fence am I on this?
And possibly if you could wave a wand and redo it, what would you have changed?
I would have liked to have directed the movie Land of the Lost, not necessarily the Will Ferrell movie, but just the movie when Land of the Lost became a motion picture. I would have loved the job of directing that, because I think that what fans wanted to see is, like, when you go camping, you arrive Friday night, and all you have time to do is quickly set up the tent, and you know, the next morning you start adjusting where the ice chest should go, because at night you didn't know that the sun was going to be beating right on that. And so there, you start to, as you're staying there over the weekend, you start to make your campsite a little more homey. Well, if we were in Land of the Lost for 40 years, don't you think I would have possibly had, like, a Sleestak skin backpack, or, you know, not because we killed them or hunted them, but just one might have keeled over from time to time, you know? We would have evolved, and I think it would have been neat to see, you know, what we did. How did we decorate our lives being there 40 years? What did we discover? You know, and I think they just bypassed all of that and turned it into this spoof, which I don't believe Land of the Lost was spoofable.
Unfortunately, whenever classic TV shows are remade for the big screen, for one reason or another, the people involved feel they have to make a joke out of it. Even when Starsky and Hutch a few years back was brought to the screen, they had to make a joke out of it. So they don't know, for some reason, they don't know how to make it just a straight adaptation.
Now, and there's plenty enough about just a regular family that could be very funny, you know.
Well, but the whole thing is, what made Land of the Lost great is that there was a logic within that illogic of that world. Whatever happened in that world made sense. It was written so well, and it wasn't a joke. It wasn't a comedy. It was some of those episodes, most of those episodes, were better written than some of the primetime series at the time. So it wasn't a joke, the way I look at it. It was a well-done series.
No, that's
series.
What I mean. I don't, you know, the Brady Bunch, because it had more of an adult audience, could be a spoofable film. But Land of the Lost was a kid's show, and it was about family and morals, and it wasn't something that I think you step on and laugh at.
Right.
But like I said, I think that there's humor in families. If they wanted to bring in some comedy relief,
right.
there was plenty of room to do it, but they didn't have to do it in that way.
Right. Which is what you did on the show as well. You had comedy relief, certainly, on the series.
Right.
But it was a natural progression of the characters. What about the remake that was in the 90s, the Land of the Lost TV show?
You know, I think I caught maybe 15 minutes of one episode. I had auditioned for that as well. And they just, with the film... We did a cameo, by the way, in the Will Ferrell film, and they cut it out. They had four different endings, and they decided to go with the one that they went with. But they also, when I auditioned, I thought for sure I was going to be cast, and they opted to go with that jungly-looking brunette girl who wasn't even, like, a Holly character at all. She was a...
Didn't they put you through a lot of measuring and all these other...
And that was for Will. That was for the Will Ferrell film. They sent out a wardrobe department to measure me and all of this, and then they sent me all my sides. And when I got on the set, they said, "You have no lines." And anyway, that's a whole other subject matter.
So the Land of the Lost TV show, the remake, was more similar to the original series. And the movie was the original series, right?
Yeah, but there was an SUV involved, and it wasn't Land of the Lost. Most people don't even, they vaguely say, wasn't there a show after your show? And I say the Will Ferrell movie, and they go, no, that one that was in between, and they can't pinpoint really what it was about. And even you had said to me, the SUV thing or whatever, you know, they had a Bronco or something.
Okay. Yes.
I have another one. The whole sleaze stack philosophy, the Altrusian, whatever it was, I can't remember the term, the crystals, all of that, was mm-hmm. that based on something like Eastern or New Age philosophy, or was it just a writer's imagination?
An Eastern philosophy? Boy, that's a good question. I don't know if it was an Eastern philosophy, but it was a... It was all those Star Trek
writers. I would say yes, because at the time, I mean, we had Kung Fu on TV, and Kung Fu debuted in 1972, right when President Nixon was holding historic talks with Chairman Mao. So that show introduced the mainstream to Asian thought. So I would say...
Well, because he talked about... you know, what would become of his people, his Sleestak, the Enoch character, would say, you know, is that what you're referring to? Yeah, he would say, you know, that if this type of behavior continues, you know, they're,
right.
we'll, you know, wind up destroying ourselves. And right. so, yeah, I guess so. I just never thought of it in that sense, but.
Because Enoch kind of sounds like the Book of Enoch, which, if you go into that realm, that's kind of like crystals and all that philosophy and metaphysicalness and things like that. So Enoch,
it was a mystical show. And usually
you have those hidden underpinnings. Maybe that's what you're. I don't know.
You said Star Trek writers, that kind of clued
me in. Right.
Well, I mean, Star Trek was very mystical too. But usually, when science fiction and fantasy cross, or when science fiction and supernatural cross in the same show, it doesn't work. But it worked well because the show it made sense. They made it work within the realm of that show's understanding. It was just very well done. DC Fontana, right? Wrote one of your favorite episodes.
Elsewhere.
Now talk a little bit about that. Why is that your favorite?
Because this woman not only was she like important to me as a role model, in the sense that in my family, I didn't have like a girly girl type woman as a sister. I had these different types of sisters, and she was very feminine, and she liked all the feminine things like hair and makeup and fashion, and she liked those things, and she was just a different kind of a woman, and I just like really bonded with her. And then off camera we became very good friends, and she helped me through some difficult things in my life. So
okay.
Yeah, I mean, why is it my favorite episode?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, yeah, because I became very good friends with her, and I just think it's a great storyline as well.
Yes. Yeah.
So there's this. I remember reading once that there were only 3 sleeve stack costumes. Is that true?
I think it was 4, but it could have just been 3. But
there were
many different sleeve stacks who wore them, or different people who wore them.
Right. But it wasn't like there was like, because I know with like the shots, it would look like there was like a bunch
following
you.
You may have seen there was an army of them chasing.
Right, but it was just the way it was shot.
Right. No, there was usually only 3 of them on the set at one time. But they were all like UCLA, USC basketball players. Bill Laimbeer was a sleeve stack from the Detroit Pistons. Yes.
I mean, I was a band lost way back when, and I gotta say, I remember I had a cutout on the paper of you know, David Greenwood and John Lambert.
Oh wow!
Back in like when it was first on, I remember they were like 6'10".
Right, right. And then when they were put in on the sleeve stack, boots had like a 7-inch lift in them. And then the point on the top of the head, I mean, these guys were...
They were almost...
Gigantic.
Yeah, because they had it, because I'm saying, well, that's something that those sleeve stacks were really, you know, they used, they had like 3, like, they made the NBA, I mean... You know,
well, some of them had like $1 million contracts. I mean...
Yeah, because they're good enough to do it, but I mean, doing the sleeve stack thing, that was kind of like their first, kind of was a part-time job. It didn't make very much.
No. No, if you work for the Crofts, you never made that much.
Well, and that was really the only issue, if there was an issue, about the shows, that the budget wasn't large or expansive, but the stories were there, the writing was there. And the acting was there. You believed that these people were in that area because you guys did such a wonderful job. So if anyone says it was camp...
Well, I can't think of the woman's name, but the woman who directed When Harry Met Sally about 3 years ago, she said that...
Bob Reiner?
Woman.
Robin Reiner, okay. Nora Ephron.
When Harry Met Sally.
No, I think that was Rob. That was Rob Reiner.
Maybe you're
thinking of Nora Ephron, who was his partner who did other movies like that.
Okay, maybe that's it. Anyway, I saw her on TV about 3 years ago, and she started talking about how you're going to see that the A-listers are going to start moving back to the small screen, because that's where the quality of writers and the real work is. It's these big blockbuster films, you know, these people who really want to tell stories and stuff, they're not interested in that kind of work. And so I think that's what happened on Land of the Lost, was there wasn't a lot of money, but it was just so interesting, you know, there were so many creative things going on that people just wanted to be a part of it, even at a smaller pay scale.
And it didn't matter, because we just loved the show. On Star Trek, on the original Star Trek, I remember DeForest Kelly, who played Dr. McCoy, he used to talk about how the thing that he would use to monitor, it was like a salt and pepper shaker from the NBC commissary, you know, that they would use. So even on that show, the budget was small. It was prime time. Okay, yes, more questions.
Can you talk about any of your favorite directors?
On the show or in general?
Either. From the show first.
Well, the first one that we had, Dennis Steinmetz, he went on to do soap operas after, but he was fun. I enjoyed him. Bob Lawley, who went on to direct the Jeffersons. He was a lot of fun. I think we had about 6 or 7 different directors, and they each brought a little something special to the show when we worked with them.
Do they have acting coaches for you guys? I mean, was that part of the setup?
No. No.
Did you ever want one? On the set?
She was a natural.
Yeah.
No, they just, you know, I went home every night with my script, and I'd stay up very late memorizing my lines, come back in, and they'd say, stand over there, run in there, grab that, come back, sit down, and say all of this and while you're doing all of that. And I just did it.
Okay.
You know, no.
So you did things instinctively that maybe some actors have to train for?
Yeah, I mean, I was just, you know, I was just there. I just, you know, I mean, I don't know if you have to train to sit down somewhere. It's just, you know, that's where we sat.
So.
Yes.
Did you ever get back into your music career?
I did some singing in my early 20s. But no, not really.
You know, I'd like to love to hear you sing, you know, bluesy, jazzy kind of stuff.
Oh, so. I've done some mad karaoke. Oh, that's right. That's right. Yeah.
Sorry. I'm not here.
Yes, about directors. I'm asked about writers. Do you have any, like, movies, anybody thinks a good writer has been over the past few years, or when you look at, hey, they've done some good stuff, or...
Well, that's interesting, because Brad Sieberling, who, well, he wasn't a writer, I'm sorry, he was a director. Okay, well, he did City of Angels.
Yeah.
Was it City? It's City of Angels with Meg Ryan and Nicolas Cage, right? Anyway, he was the one who directed the Will Ferrell version of Land of the Lost. But when I went in to meet him on my first meeting with him, and I was so excited that it was going to be him because I love City of Angels. I thought, oh, this guy is so metaphysical and so, like, open-minded about so many things. And when I met him in our interview, he was so, like, warm and open. And he sat there with me, and he's just, like, really, like, real neat. Like, a neat kind of a guy, like, the kind I can gel with. And then on the set, just all of that just disappeared. And he produced this, and I thought, God, boy, that took me by surprise.
It's probably the studio, you know, telling him what to do with the movie more than, you know.
How did Sid and Marty Krupp, what do they think of the movie?
Well, I haven't heard really anything out of Sid, but Marty says that he really does want to do Land of the Lost like how he wanted to do it. I think it's just the whole money thing, you know. It's tough.
Because it's really not essentially about creativity. It's always about the money more times than not.
And what people will never get through their thick skulls is that the money will come. Put the richness in the product and the money will follow.
I say right now would be a great time because now with the popularity of Jurassic World, I mean, that dinosaur theme would be a great time to really make a push to...
And it's possible because they remade The Incredible Hulk only a couple years after that first film. So it is possible to just get right back on the horse.
Well, I can tell you that David Gerald, who I said, I told you guys early in the evening that he was the creator, it would take somebody like him who really had an understanding of what the original show was all about to rewrite a new storyline. And he's about 50% done with Land of the Lost, the book. And when that's completed, he will turn that into a screenplay. And the Crofts mentioned this at Comic-Con a few months back. And David had mentioned it in front of like 6,000 people at the Star Trek convention a couple of years ago. So, and he pulled us, Wesley, the brother, and I pulled us on stage, and he made that announcement in front of a lot of people. So, but this is like such cool stuff. We had a sibling. That's his storyline. We had a little brother, mm-hmm. that, you know, in every family, there's always that young one that the mother says, you know, you can go next year. You know, they're going to go, and it'll come your turn. You'll be old enough, maybe, you know, by next year, and you can go on a rafting trip with them. Anyway, 40 years later, he comes looking for us in the Land of Lost. So we will be, myself and Wesley and Chaka, the original cast, will be in the new film. Yeah. Very exciting. I think it's so cool that we had a sibling. It just, you know, like I said, it would take somebody who knew the dynamics of it from the get-go to come up with that, you know.
Wow, cool.
Isn't that neat?
It is awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
You brought up Wesley. He was kind of a heartthrob back in the day.
Oh, yeah.
Was there anything on the set between you and him?
No. No, yeah. He's like 10 years older than I am, and that makes a major difference when you're that age, you know. Yeah. My boyfriend today is 10 years older than me, and it makes no difference. There's no difference. But when you're 12 and the other person's, you know...
And you had those issues that you had, just like with your real family. You talked about that in the book, that, you know, you wanted the bigger limo, and he got the little limo, or...
Oh, no, that was just when we were doing the narration on the videos for the box set that you guys have. Yeah, I just happened to get a bigger limousine than him. So, as far as, like, there wasn't any, like, I didn't have a crush on him. You had mentioned him being a heartthrob. Nothing like that. As a matter of fact, Chaka and I were closer in age, and he had a crush on me. And so, but we hung out together. I just thought he was, like, a friend, because I didn't see that. I didn't see that he had a crush on me. I just thought that we were friends. But apparently, he has told me, you know, of course, years later, that he did, and da-da-da-da-da. Anyway.
Now, was that Paley? Is that his name?
Yeah, Philip Paley.
Was he related to Paley of CBS?
No. But we did, banter back and forth, Wesley and I. Oh, big time. He's the one who taught me, like, he was a camera hog. Because he was older and experienced, and he knew, like, how to get that last close-up, you know? And so he pushed me into the bushes, and he turned around. And we had this ongoing game where, you know, we'd start ad-libbing. After the lines, all the dialogue had been said, he'd have to turn around and say, "Yeah, that was good, Holly." And so I let it slide for a while, and then it was like, "Really, Will? Thanks." And I started ad-libbing myself, and then he'd say, "Yeah, it was." And so it was whoever could get the last line in before they cut the tape. You know, so.
I love it.
And we're still like that. And by the way, I see the cast all the time, and we're very, very, very close.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Well, Kathleen, thank you so much.
Oh, my pleasure.
It was just such a pleasure having you.
Thank you all for coming. This is super. Thank you so much.
She's going to be signing books right over here, right next to me, where I'm going to be signing my Elizabeth Montgomery books as well. Thank you, guys. Next week, we have, Gloria Loring. And in future weeks, Don Wells, Gilligan's Island, and Kathy Garver from Family Affair, and Anson Williams from Happy Days. So please stick with us, and thank you very much. Peace.
Yay.
Oh, yes, sir.
I was wondering, how can we contribute to the classic television preservation?
Thank you very much.
Good question.
Thank you very much. You can contribute right tonight. In that little plastic container. I dedicate my life to the positive influence of classic TV. This is what I do. So whatever contributions you can make would be lovely and appreciated. And if not...
And by the way, thank you so much.
Oh, thank you.
So God bless you all, and let's...